There's something written on your heart. It's the guiding force in your life. And when the storms of life come, the writing comes to the surface. Your story and all of its baggage is written on your heart. But there's another story, and God says that we are to write it on our hearts. The Bible. 66 books with over 30,000 verses. Now that sounds like a pretty tall order. But Jesus' life provides the perfect example of Scripture that is etched on the heart. When Jesus is tempted by Satan in the wilderness, his response is straight out of Deuteronomy. On his way to being crucified, Jesus continues to quote Scripture. And finally, as Jesus surrenders his spirit, he quotes Psalm 22. His Father's words were on the front of his mind and on the tip of his tongue at every moment. But Jesus didn't just know the Scriptures. He lived the Scriptures. They weren't just words on a page to him. They were the foundation upon which he built his life. And God invites us to do the same. But Jesus said something pretty shocking about the Scriptures. He confronted a group of religious leaders who were trying to earn eternal life by studying the Scriptures and said to them, "You're looking in the wrong place. The Scriptures all point to one thing, me. For I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So don't think that the Scriptures lead to eternal life. They don't. They lead to Jesus, the author of eternal life. And studying them is not about knowing a bunch of nice sayings. It's about knowing a person, Jesus. To know Jesus is to know Scripture. And to know Scripture is to know the heart of the Father. For it contains the very words of God. His words were meant to become a part of you, to course through your veins, to be lived out. Something is written on your heart, and it's either your words or God's, either your story or God's story. So may you find your place in God's story. May you delight in His Word. And may that Word be forever written on your heart.
Good morning. My name is Ramona Baker Sipes, and I will be doing the prayer. Let's bow our heads and still ourselves and think of all the many blessings that we have received and are still receiving this very minute. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and tender mercies, for waking us up this morning to see another day and another new year. As we progress into this new year, we see there is a need for healing among all of the chaos, the division, destructive and numerous distractions that we will face on a daily basis. Is there a balm in Gilead? Dear Heavenly Father, there is a need for healing of our minds, bodies, and souls, to learn the importance of self-care and healing before we can take care of others. There's a need for healing of this nation, which appears to be so divided. There's a lack of discernment, selfishness, greed, and at times refusing to seek or listen to the truth. There's a need for healing of this world. Climate change has led to drought in many places that previously had water. And this has resulted in poverty, sickness, and even death in many cases. Natural disasters have caused flooding, fires, and total communities have been destroyed. Dear Heavenly Father, there's a need of healing for those who have lost loved ones during this pandemic and who are grieving. Yes, there is a balm in Gilead. Jesus is the true healer and restorer. Heavenly Father, help us to hold on to your unchanging hands, to trust in you and keep calm, for you are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. These and all the other blessings we ask in thy son's Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, family. My name is Holly Riley, and I'll be bringing you this morning's scripture, Psalms 113 of the NIV. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, you his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all of the nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, the one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the heavens and the earth? He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with the princes of his people. He settles the childless woman in her home as a happy mother of children. Praise the Lord.
Hello, my name is Daniel Felder, and today I'll be reading the affirmation of faith for you. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, and then the third day he rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Let us consider 1 Samuel chapter 3 as our scriptural foundation for our meditation this morning. The New Living Translation says it like this. Meanwhile, the boy Samuel served the Lord by assisting Eli. Now, in those days, messages from the Lord were very rare and visions were quite uncommon. One night, Eli, who was almost blind by now, had gone to bed. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was sleeping in the tabernacle near the ark of God. Suddenly, the Lord called out, "Samuel." "Yes," Samuel replied. "What is it?" He got up and ran to Eli. "Here I am. Did you call me?" "I didn't call you," Eli replied. "Go back to bed." So he did. Then the Lord called out again, "Samuel." Again, Samuel got up and went to Eli. "Here I am. Did you call me?" "I didn't call you, my son," Eli said. "Go back to bed." Samuel did not yet know the Lord because he had never had a message from the Lord before. So the Lord called a third time. And once more, Samuel got up and went to Eli. "Here I am. Did you call me?" Then Eli realized it was the Lord who was calling the boy. So he said to Samuel, "Go and lie down again. And if someone calls again, say, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went back to bed. And the Lord came and called as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel replied, "Speak, your servant is listening." I love the call story of Samuel. If you recall, Hannah's heart's desire was to have a son, but she promised that if God gave her the desire of her heart, she would give it back to God. So Hannah kept her promise. And when the boy was weaned, she dropped him off at the temple and committed his care to Eli, the priest. In the beginning of the text, we learn that Samuel was in the beginning of living out his purpose. Matter of fact, your Bible says that he was ministering before the Lord. He was assisting Eli, the priest. He was working in the temple. He had a job. He had an assignment. He was not there because he made a conscious decision to serve. He was not there because he felt a calling, but he was there because his mother made a promise to God. Don't miss this. Because of Hannah's promise, Samuel had been strategically placed in the presence of God, and God had a strategic assignment for Samuel to complete. Initially, the assignment was to help Eli. But eventually, the assignment would be to help an entire nation. Your Bible lets us know that the word of the Lord was rare during the time that Samuel was growing up in the temple. Don't get it twisted. God has always been speaking. God has always been revealing God's self to us. But there are some seasons when the prophets and the preachers are quiet. There are some seasons when people do not have ears to hear what God is saying, because it may require them to sacrifice or change or pray or love or submit to things that make them uncomfortable. Perhaps the other reason that there were not many prophetic voices is because maybe, just maybe, God needed some time to raise up a generation of prophets who would be committed from birth to a life of ministry. Nevertheless, it is under these familiar conditions that we meet young Samuel. So in the middle of the night, Samuel hears someone calling his name. Each time, he thinks it's Eli. Each time, he's wrong. What we cannot miss is the fact that Samuel answered every time. Although he mistook the voice, he did not ignore the voice. He moved to answer quickly. He was being trained to serve. So when he heard his name, he went running in the direction of the call. He did not hesitate. He did not pretend to be sleeping through the call. He simply responded with his presence. Verse 7 of the text tells us that Samuel didn't know the Lord yet, because he had never had a message from the Lord before. Yes, Samuel was in the temple being taught how to serve God. But up until that moment, he did not yet have a relationship with God. He was not familiar with the sound of God's voice. Watch this. He was accustomed to being pulled in God's direction, but he didn't know what it was like to be called into God's presence for a conversation. The other character in our text this morning is Eli, the priest. But once again, he is slow to pick up on the movements of God. Watch this. If you remember when Hannah showed up in the temple and fell on her knees and was praying and crying and travailing so deeply, Eli assumed that she was drunk. He was the priest, but he didn't recognize prayer. My God. He was a man of God, but he didn't recognize a move of God. And now here he is again in the middle of the night. His young charge, Samuel, keeps waking him up. And it takes three times for him to realize that God was yet moving again. After the third time, Eli says, "If you hear somebody calling you again, it's not me, but it's God. Don't be scared. Just tell God that you're listening." And sure enough, Samuel hears the voice calling again, and he answers. I just want to share five things that this particular story of Samuel's call taught me. Number one, the prayers of our parents really do shape our purpose. Hannah prayed, and God not only blessed her with a child, but he wrapped a prophetic destiny around her child's life. Samuel wasn't just living in the temple, but he was learning there. He was growing there. Samuel actually met God in the temple. Watch this. I believe that God is still answering the prayers of mothers and fathers. I believe that God is still meeting young people at the temple. Now you may pause. You may say, "Pastor T, how is that possible? We're not physically meeting in the temple." Well, if you're watching this virtual meeting, I just believe that you have a desire for God to meet you wherever you are. You have an expectation that God will meet you wherever you are. And God is meeting you and your young people. Why? Because we prayed. God is meeting you and your young people. Why? Because the word of the Lord has been rare, just like in Samuel's day. And God has an agenda. God is looking to grow up some young people. God is looking to call out some young people in the direction of ministry and service. But watch this. The temple may not look like it used to look. Ministry may not look like it used to look, but God is calling and preparing young people to answer the call that so many others have ignored. I know I keep signaling out young people. That's just because Samuel is young in the text, but I want you to hear me say that God doesn't just call the young people. God is calling people of all ages, genders, sizes, and shapes to go out and take ministry to a new level. I want you to look me in my face and hear me when I say to you that God is calling you. Your parents prayed for you to be used by God. Your parents prayed that you would be a blessing. Now, it might not be in the pulpit. It might not be on the praise team. Maybe God is calling you to pray. Maybe God is calling you to encourage. My point is, God is calling you to do something, even in the midst of a pandemic. The next thing that I learned from this text is that the call is about God's need and not your ability. That's good. Listen, in the beginning of the text, we learned that the word of the Lord was rare. Signs and miracles and wonders were rare. When we meet Samuel, he's not teaching or praying or prophesying. He's not being trained in history and theology. He is simply helping Eli. Samuel was taking out the trash and washing linens, and he was cooking meals and running errands. Watch this. God doesn't wait until you're fully degreed and ready for the assignment. Usually the call comes before you really know what God is about to throw you into. God calls us because somewhere there is a need for whatever it is that he's placed on the inside of us. God calls us because he's imprinted in our DNA everything that is necessary for the assignment. The call to ministry is a call to study. It's a call to prepare. It's a call to grow. It's a call to trust in the Lord and lean not unto your own understanding. When God called Samuel, he didn't have the necessary skills and nuances to be a prophet and priest. All he had was a yes. Listen. That's the third thing that the text taught me. God's call cannot be answered if you are not willing. Every time Samuel heard his name, he responded. God has been calling some of us even during these pandemic months. God has been calling some of us to very specific ministries. Watch this, the ministry of calling and checking on people, the ministry of making sure that your neighbor's driveway gets shoveled, the ministry of sharing the link to your church's online ministry, the ministry of remembering your pastor and church family in prayer. How many opportunities have you ignored? How many ministry moments have you let slip by you? How many times did you tell God you would do it later? Listen, I'm guilty. How many times did you flat out tell God no? Because you just didn't feel like moving. We've all done it. We're all guilty. But the good news is that God hasn't run out of assignments. God is still calling us into some new levels of service. And now more than ever, we need to be willing to go with God. The text also reminds us that in the midst of every call, there was a moment of creation. In the text, God calls Samuel's name four times before he responds. Four is the number of creation. Watch this. I shared a few minutes ago that Samuel didn't have it all together at the time of his calling, but God took advantage of the call moment to create a heart for ministry within Samuel. Don't get it twisted. Samuel already had a heart for service, but he didn't have a heart for ministry yet. He really didn't know too much about God at the time of his calling, but after his encounter with God, everything changed for him. You already know that God is calling you. So my prayer for you is that you have an encounter with God. My prayer is that you would have an experience with God that causes you to hear his voice clearly so that you will know beyond the shadow of a doubt what God sounds like. I pray that when you know God's voice, that you will respond as Samuel did. Samuel responded quickly. He responded with hope and not anxiety. He responded with joy and not doubt. Because if God calls you to something, watch this. God has already considered all of the doors that he needs to open for you to fulfill the assignment. Finally, the story of the call of Samuel teaches us that we have to learn to follow directions. When Eli finally caught on to what was really happening to Samuel, he says, the next time it happens, tell God you're listening. Yes, God calls us to worship and to sing praises. Yes, God wants us to talk to him and tell him all about our struggles. Yes, God wants us to serve and please him. But I think that what God wants more from us at this very moment is to know that we are listening. Do we have ears to hear what God is saying? Do you want to hear God? Are you actively and intentionally seeking opportunities to still your heart and mind so that you can hear what God is saying? When you wake up in the middle of the night, or if you can't go to sleep, could God be creating an opportunity for you to hear his voice? I dare you right there where you are to just say, God, I'm listening. Come on, do it again. God, I'm listening. I dare you to stop what you're doing and say, God, here I am. You've got my full attention. I want to hear you. So, Father, thank you for reminding us today that you have called each of us into your ministry. Thank you for reminding us that it's not about our skills or ability, but it's all about your power and your plan. Help us, oh God, to hear and respond to your voice. Help us to do it with intention. God, I pray that you would help all of the Elis in our lives to become more in tune with how you move. So that when the time comes, they can share with us what the proper instruction is. Thank you for even wanting to use somebody like us. Open up our ears. We want to hear you. And we want to go with you in all the ways that you're leading. That's our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That's what I got out of the text. I'd love to hear how this text spoke to you. Feel free in the comments on Facebook or YouTube to share your heart with us.
Are you ready to discover a path for worship that frees you to be you? Are you ready to connect with God and grow spiritually the best way that fits your personality? If you are, then join us for our combined Bible study starting on Wednesday, February 2nd at 7 p.m. We are studying the book Sacred Pathways by Gary Thomas. Our host will be Dr. Tawana Harris from Carter Metropolitan CME Church, Pastor Antoine Johnson from Wallace Temple AME Zion, and Dr. Ricky McCray from The Way Church. Join us on Facebook and YouTube. Are you ready to deepen your relationship with God? Order your book now, Sacred Pathways by Gary Thomas. Then join us on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. See you there.
I want you to look me in my face and hear me when I say to you that it is my prayer to God that the Lord bless you and keep you, that the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you, that the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon all of you and give you peace, now, henceforth, and forevermore. And all God's people said, amen.